मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रन. सो आई एम बैक अगेन विथ अनदर वीडियो लेसन ऑफ बायोलॉजी ऑफ क्लास सिक्स. एंड टुडे आई विल बी मीन्स यूजिंग और आई विल बी स्टार्टिंग अ न्यू चैप्टर दैट इज द लीफ. ओके एंड दिस इज पार्ट वन. दो मेनी ऑफ माई स्टूडेंट्स हैव ऑलरेडी स्टार्टेड विद द नेक्स्ट चैप्टर्स. सो टुडे आई विल बी स्टार्टिंग एंड आई विल बी एक्सप्लेनिंग ईच एंड एवरी पार्ट. एंड इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेरी यू कैन पुट इट इन द ग्रुप. ओके बाई एन ऑडियो मैसेज. So let's begin. Now, children, what do you mean by a leaf? Okay, you have seen leaves the time when you had some sense that yes, these are parts of the leaves and all. So you know that those green structures which you see on the plant are the leaves. Okay. Now, what is given in the book? Let us see. And you should have your books open when I am dealing with this video. Okay. Because I'll be taking major all the important parts from the book itself. Okay, now, so the flat green broad part of the shoot. You know that a flat green, which is flat and green colored, and it is broad part of the shoot. It is a part of the shoot system, and it is located on the node of the stem. I hopefully you know what is the node of the stem. I have written there also. The node is the point at which the leaf is attached to the stem. So the point where the leaf is attached to the stem is the node. Okay, and this leaf, if you ask the definition of a leaf, then it is a flat green broad part of the shoot located at the node of the stem. Okay, now this leaf is green in color, we know, and it is, why it is green in color, that also we are aware of, that it is due to the green pigment which is present in the leaf, that is chlorophyll. Chlorophyll's pigment, this spelling should be learned by you all. Many of you write the wrong spellings. So chlorophyll is the pigment. Now, what is the function of this chlorophyll pigment in the leaves? It helps in photosynthesis because it can trap solar energy and that is light energy, and it changes it that light energy into chemical energy that is in the form of glucose and forms food for the plant. Now, the entire set of leaves in the plant is known as its foliage. Now, all the leaves which are present in a particular plant is known as the foliage of that plant. That is, the entire set of leaves in a plant is its foliage. Now, leaves grow in an acropetal order. What do you mean by acropetal order? Leaves grow in an acropetal order. This means that the younger leaves, which are very small and just newly they have come up, they grow towards the tip of the plant. Okay, and the older ones and the larger leaves, they are farther away from the tip of the plant. They are in the lower position, and the new ones which are growing, they are at the tip of the plant. That is called acropetal succession or acropetal order. That is, it refers to the arrangement of the flowers or leaves. Okay, acropetal succession, that term is used for both flowers as well as leaves. Acropetal succession, succession. Okay, acropetal succession, this refers to the arrangement of flowers or leaves in such a way that the new flowers or leaves are at the top of the plant, and the older ones, that is the older flowers or leaves, are at the bottom. Okay, this is called acropetal succession. Now, node, I have already told you, that is the point at which the leaf is attached to the stem is the node. Now, let us go to the next slide. Now, we'll deal with the parts of the leaf. What are the different parts of the leaf? It is written in the book. Just have a look there. A typical leaf has three distinct parts. What are the three parts? A leaf blade or lamina, okay, the stalk or the petiole, okay, and the leaf base. So these three are the parts. Now, the leaf blade or the lamina, that is the broad part which we can see on the leaf, that the whole part where the veins and midrib are all present, that is the lamina. Stalk or petiole, that is the stalk by which the leaf is attached to the stem, is the petiole, and the leaf base is the point or the point at which the leaf is attached is called the node. But the petiole's base, that is the base of the petiole towards where it is attached to the stem, that part is known as the leaf base. Okay. Now, in this diagram, you can see all the parts. They are labeled here very nicely. And we will see in the book also what they are there. Okay. What are the things they are written there? The leaf base is located at the junction of the petiole. Okay. At the junction of the petiole. Junction means at the point of attachment of the petiole and the stem. So where the petiole is attaching with the stem, that part is known as the leaf base, and the point is known as the node. Okay, The angle between the petiole and the stem is called the axils. Now see, children, in the other diagram, second diagram, which is there in the slide, I have marked the axil there. Can you see? The angle between the petiole. Petiole is the stalk of the leaf, and the stem is called the axil. The main stem and the petiole is forming an angle. See, an angle is formed. That is called the axil. Okay? And there is a small bud which is there. Okay? Which is known as the axillary bud, which is present in the axil of the leaf. Always in a leaf, the axil will be having the axillary bud. Okay? Clear? Now, petiole. Now, what is petiole? It is a stalk by which the leaf lamina is attached to the main stem. Leaf lamina means the whole broad part of the leaf is attached to the main stem by a small stalk, which is known as the petiole. P-E-T-I-O-L-E. Okay? Petiole. Now, what is leaf base? The part of the leaf in contact with the stem at the node. Okay? Leaf base is not the part of the stem. Okay? It is the part of the leaf itself. Leaf means at the base of the petiole, below the petiole. That is actually called the leaf base. So, leaf base is a part of the leaf in contact with the stem at the node. Lamina, the broad and expanded part of the leaf, that is the whole green part of the leaf which has the midrib and the veins and all these things, that is actually the lamina. And this lamina is broad and flat, so it is well adapted to absorb sunlight and carbon dioxide for photosynthesis. We know that carbon dioxide and sunlight both are required for photosynthesis. Okay? Midrib and veins. The continuation of the stem into the leaf or lamina forms the midrib, which branches into a network of veins. So, what it is telling? Midrib, the continuation of the stem. The stem is continued into the leaf, inside the leaf, it is in the lamina. Leaf means in the lamina, which forms the midrib. Can you see a middle line along the lamina? That is called the midrib, which branches into a network of veins. You know, also some lateral veins are there and some veinlets are also there. Okay, so these veins are present on the midrib, as well as the lateral veins are present in the lamina. Leaf apex or leaf and leaf margin. Leaf apex and leaf margin. Leaf apex is also known as the leaf tip. Okay, leaf tip or leaf apex. Now, the tip of the lamina is called the leaf apex. See in the diagram, children, leaf apex is marked. The pointed part at the corner of the leaf is known as the leaf apex. And the edge on all the sides is called the leaf margin. What is the leaf margin? See, the leaf margin is also marked there. Can you see the wavy line on the sides? That is called the leaf margin. Veinlets. What are veinlets? We know about veins. The veins, again, divide and subdivide. They means branch. Okay? They profusely branch to form a network of veinlets which keep the leaf in expanded form. Otherwise, they will roll, okay? And help in conduction of food, water and minerals. Now, what do the veins and veinlets do? These veinlets actually are what? The midrib branches into lateral veins, and the lateral veins again branches into veinlets. And what is the function of these veinlets? They help in keeping the leaf in an expanded form, that is fully flat, it remains, so that it can absorb more amount of sunlight and also helps in conduction of food, water and minerals. From the roots, the water and minerals are taken from the soil, and the food which is prepared by the leaf is taken by these veinlets and are distributed to all the parts of the plant. Okay, let us go into the next slide. Now here we will discuss about the types of leaves, children. Okay, keep your books with you. Okay. Now, types of leaves, whenever we are talking about the types of leaves, there are two types of leaves which come into our mind, the simple leaves and compound leaves. Only these two major subdivisions are there. Minor subdivisions are there, but these are the two major subdivisions, simple leaves and compound leaves. Now, what do you mean by the simple leaves and compound leaves? Let us see. Now, simple leaves. The leaves which have a single undivided lamina. Undivided lamina means lamina, you know, the whole broad part of the leaf. That is not the petiole, okay? The broad part of the leaf is known as the leaf lamina. Now, when this lamina is not divided into any sections, it is a complete single one, okay? It is known as a simple leaf. In these leaves, the various small or deep incisions present on the leaves never touch the midrib. What they are trying to say? See, in the diagram which is I have shown just beside the simple leaf, a small one which is showing the bud also, okay? Simple leaf, it is written there. Now, simple leaf, can you see? There is a big lamina which is present, which is attached to the by the petiole to the main stem. Okay, and you can see a bud also there, isn't it? So this is a simple leaf where the incisions. Incisions means what? The bifurcations are there, some cuts are there, okay? Those cuts do not reach up to the, in your book, the leaf which is drawn there, can you see some wavy lines are there? Those wavy lines are confined to the margin and they have not gone to the midrib. So this is a simple leaf where the whole lamina is a single one. It is not divided into parts, okay? It is undivided. And always remember, one more easy trick I'll tell you how to understand which is a simple leaf and a compound leaf. Let me first complete compound leaf, okay? Now, examples of simple leaves are mango, jamun, peepal, etc. So, mango, peepal, all these, trees, leaves you have seen, they are all simple leaves, okay? Let us now come to the compound leaves. What do you mean by compound leaves? The leaves in which the lamina is divided into small segments which are attached to the midrib. Now, in case of compound leaves, the midrib is not called midrib, it is called the rachis, okay? It is called the rachis. Now, compound leaves, midrib is known as the rachis, and its branches or the tip of the petiole are called compound leaves. Now, see the diagram, children, the compound leaf, the small diagram where a leaflet is written. Can you see there is a long midrib to which small leaves are attached. Now, these small leaves are actually called leaflets, not leaf. Because this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 leaves, what you see, leaflets, what you see together, these 5 leaflets together form one leaf, okay? So, these are compound leaves. What has happened here? The whole leaf has been divided into 5 segments, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And what are these 5 segments called? Each one of them are called the leaflets, okay? Now, how can you understand that this is a compound leaf and this is a simple leaf? Now, always remember, children, whenever it is a leaf, okay, there at the base of the petiole or the where the petiole is attaching to the main stem, there will be a bud, okay? Can you see in the simple leaf, the point where the petiole is attaching to the stem, there is a bud, so it is a simple leaf, okay? But can you see that where the leaflets are attached to the rachis or the midrib in compound leaves, can you see? Where the leaflets are attached to this midrib or the rachis, there no buds are there. But yes, where all these leaflets are attaching to the main stem, there a bud is present. So, this all 5 leaflets together form a total leaf. So, what is happening here? The whole simple leaf is getting subdivided into small leaflets. Now, compound leaf, very good examples are the rose, neem, all these are very good examples of leaflets. What happens in compound leaves? The big leaf is not there. The big leaf is divided into small leaflets. And how can we distinguish between a simple leaf and a compound leaf? Whenever we see that the end of the leaf is having a bud, that is the axillary bud, which we talked about in the axil, okay? Then that is a simple leaf. And when the leaflets of the compound leaf are not having a bud each with their at the base of the leaflet, that means it is a compound leaf, okay? Now you can see the diagram in the compound leaf, a big means this box, black colored box, which you can see a compound leaf. So see the one which I told you is written here. Can you see there is no bud in this black color diagram, okay, with the leaf, compound leaf. Where the bud is present, see where all each leaflet doesn't have bud. They have, see, it is written there, no bud. See, here also no bud in the leaflets, at the base of the leaflets. Is there any bud? No. So, they are not leaves. They are leaflets. And which is, where is the bud present? At the end, that is at the base of the petiole, at the leaf base, the bud is present. So, this whole structure is actually the leaf. And these small parts are called the leaflets. So, the petioles end wherever it is, see, we have to see the bud there. If the bud is present at the base, that means this whole 5 leaflets, or here at, in the black diagram, there are 7 leaves. So, these 7 leaves together form one leaf. And this each part is known as the leaflets. You can see that one big leaf, this one, the B diagram, this one big one is the simple leaf. And all these small parts together in a compound leaf together form one leaf. Okay. Now, we'll come to venation. Now, what is actually venation? Okay, means what is the definition of venation? The arrangement of midrib, veins and veinlets in a leaf. So, how the midrib, veins and veinlets are arranged in a leaf, we term that as the venation. So, the mode of arrangement of midrib, veins and veinlets in a leaf is known as venation of the leaf. Now there are two types of venation, parallel venation and reticulate venation. Okay. Now in parallel venation, what happens in the leaves of grass? Grass is a very good example of parallel venation. Also banana and all are there also. Now in the leaves of grass, the veins are parallel to one another. Can you see they are moving in the diagram? They are parallel to one another and they are not forming any network kind of thing. So they are parallel venation. And reticulate venation, if the design is net-like on both the sides of the midrib, the venation is reticulate venation. See, there is a network formed. Now remember children, very good idea of understanding which is reticulate venation and which is parallel venation is that the reticulate venation, there will be network formed of the veins and veinlets. Okay. Whereas in parallel venation, there will be no network formed. Okay. So, reticulate venation, if the veins and veinlets form a network from the midrib, the venation is known as reticulate venation. There may be a single midrib arising from the tip of the petiole to the apex of the leaf or many midribs. See in the reticulate venation diagram, see how many midribs are going. See 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 are going. Okay, so there might be many midribs in the reticulate venation part or there might be only single one. This is commonly found in the leaves of dicot plants. Reticulate venation is generally seen in dicot plants. Hopefully you have studied, I know that in class 5, what are dicotyledonous plant and what are monocotyledonous plant. The dicot plants, the dicotyledonous plants, their seeds have two cotyledons and the monocotyledonous plants have only one cotyledon in their seeds. So examples are peepal, mango, they have this reticulate venation. And in parallel venation, if the veins and veinlets, they run parallel to each other towards the tip of the leaf or towards the margin of the leaf, then it is known as parallel venation. So the veins and veinlets will be running parallel to each other towards the tip or towards the margin. So there will be no network formation. And this parallel venation is mainly seen in the leaves of monocot plants, that is monocotyledonous plants, which have single cotyledon in the seeds. Sugarcane, wheat, rice, maize, all these are examples of monocotyledonous plant. Okay. Now children, in the next slide you can see I have given two more diagrams of parallel venation and reticulate venation, where you can see the reticulate venation, the network formation is very nicely seen. This is a tulsi leaf, okay, and it is seen in dicot plants. This is where reticulate venation, whereas in case of parallel venation, can you see they are going parallel to each other, the lines are going parallel to each other, so it is seen in monocot plants. Okay, hopefully you understood. Okay, phyllotaxy. Now, many questions came in the query part about phyllotaxy also. Now, what is phyllotaxy? The arrangement of leaves on the nodes of the stem and branches is known as phyllotaxy. Now, how the leaves are arranged in the nodes of the stem and its branches is known as phyllotaxy. What is the manner of arrangement of the leaves? That is known as phyllotaxy. How the leaves are arranged, okay? Now, what is the advantage of phyllotaxy? It prevents overcrowding. For example, in a particular place, all the leaves are crowding. Then what will happen? It will be overcrowded. So that prevents overcrowding. Helps in better exposure of leaf to sunlight. So questions can be asked, how is phyllotaxy advantageous? So prevents overcrowding and helps in better exposure. Exposure means the sunlight falls on the leaves in a better way. The phyllotaxy is of three types: alternate phyllotaxy, opposite phyllotaxy, and whorled phyllotaxy. Okay. Now see, I have given diagrams of all the three. In opposite phyllotaxy, you can see, or the alternate one is given first, so I will read the alternate one. If a single leaf is borne alternately at each node, it is called alternate phyllotaxy. Rhodes, castor, peepal, China rose, sunflower, etc. are the examples. See, in alternate, in one node, only one leaf is there. See, in the first, only one. See, in the second node, again one. In the third node, again one. Only one leaf is there attached to the nodes, that is alternate, they are alternately arranged. In opposite phyllotaxy, what we can see that if two leaves are borne on either side of the same node, see, on the same node two leaves are borne are present, so two leaves and one node on either side, so that is opposite. The phyllotaxy is said to be opposite, and tulsi, jasmine and guava are the examples of this type of phyllotaxy, it is opposite phyllotaxy. In case of whorled phyllotaxy, what we can see that in a particular node, what we know, what is node? Node is the point at which the leaves arise, or the location of the point at which the leaves arise is known as the node. Now in whorled phyllotaxy, what we see that at a particular node, there are more than three leaves, okay? Three or more leaves are born at each node. That is actually known as the whorled phyllotaxy, and it is seen in Nerium. Nerium is some Bengali students might know that is Korobi gach. Okay, we can see this world phyllotaxy there. So these are the different types of phyllotaxy. In the alternate one, what we can see that leaves are borne alternately, one in each node, not on both the sides, one in each node. In case of opposite, two leaves are present on one node on either side. In case of bold phyllotaxy, there are three or more leaves present at each node. Okay. Now, what are the general functions of leaf? Now, main function of leaf, we know that it performs photosynthesis. What is photosynthesis? The process by which green plants prepare their food with the help of carbon dioxide, water in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. We know that photosynthesis is performed by the leaves, the main function. Now, exchange of gases. Now, what do you mean by exchange of gases? Now, you know, children, that in leaves, there are some tiny openings which are known as stomata. Now, for photosynthesis, you know that some of the gases are required, or and for respiration also some gases are required. That is carbon dioxide for photosynthesis, and for respiration oxygen is required. Okay, now these gases will enter and leave from the plant or from the leaf through which part? That is from the stomata. Can you see in the leaf? I have shown the stomata. Carbon dioxide is entering, water is moving out. That is, water is moving out means transpiration is taking place. Okay. So, stomata, a big diagram is also, I have shown an open and a closed stomata. I have shown here, first one is the open stomata and next one is the B1 is the closed stomata. So, exchange of gases, that is the gases are exchanged by the stomata, that is which are present on the leaf. Transpiration, that is extra water which is not needed by the plant is moved out, or excess water is moved in the form of water vapor through these stomata by the leaf. Reproduction. Where reproduction have you seen in class 5? Hopefully you remember about bryophyllum, vegetative propagation or vegetative reproduction. There what you read, that bryophyllum, on the margins of the bryophyllum leaf, some small these buds are there, adventitious buds, which when fall on the ground, they grow into new plants. Okay. So reproduction is also seen in case of leaves. Leaves also help in this reproduction. So, for today, it is all about the chapter, children. You will go through the this one slide nicely. All the slides, all the audio which I have spoken, go through it. Any question you have, you can ask in the group from the part which I have taught you. Okay, not from the part which I have not taught you. From the part which I have taught you, you can ask any questions. Okay, till then, thank you.